What we're going to do right now is talk about what music therapy is, how I've done mine, and then we'll have Nanette, Fabian, or Florian talk about her her aspect of music therapy and her website, which is fabulous. But I'm going to give a little background to those people who don't know me. And also, if you have questions, put them in the chat. I'll see them. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. I see some people don't have a camera. Just put your questions there and we'll get to them. I can see your questions. All right, I'm going to give a little background. My name is Richard Pocker. I had a progressive hearing loss from the time I was 7. I had scarlet fever, and it was either the drugs or the scarlet fever that started the progressive hearing loss. And I wore hearing aids from the age of 7 until I was 30. And I suffered a total collapse within a month of both my ears. I went to zero speech comprehension. And even today, if I take my cochlear implants off, you can shoot a firecracker behind my head. I'm not going to turn around. And so what we have here is a situation where I went from zero hearing to I had both cochlear implants done in one operation simultaneously, which is very rare. My biggest fear was why I put it off for 35 years. You're looking at the records behind me. It was music. I was afraid to lose the fidelity of music. And when I lost my hearing when I was 30, at that time, my wife and I had tickets to the Metropolitan Opera every New Year's Eve. They were precious. And after that, it was gone. The music was gone. At the time, it was probably correct that the fidelity of cochlear implants was not that good. They were made for speech. And I was waiting 35 years for a cure for deafness. It was a question of hoping there would be a drug, hoping there would be a cure so I could keep the fidelity of music. And I realized after 35 years that just as people today are waiting for this FX322 drug to restore the hearing in the cochlea, I waited all that time for it. I moved to Florida 8 years ago. I went into Costco to get stuff for this new house. And I saw the hearing aid area. And I said, well, maybe something's changed in 35 years. So I signed up for a hearing test. I got it 2 weeks later. And the hearing aid expert said to me, oh, you're deaf as a post. And I said, I know that. There's nothing new there. But it was a few weeks later, I discovered somebody in the gym wearing a cochlear implant and found out where I live in Sarasota, Florida, is a mecca for cochlear implants. And that moved me forward. Okay, now, still my biggest worry was music, because to me, I believe, like Charles Darwin, music is more important than speech. And I held off because of that. But I had no choice. I mean, I was 65, almost 65 years old, and I decided to take a chance. Again, I was told music wouldn't come back, but okay, there you go. Fortunately, the doctors were wrong. Music does come back to most of us, not everyone. It's not 100%. I'm not a professional musician. I don't sing. If I sing, you'll all leave this webinar in a second. So that listening to music was important. And cochlear implants take time. Quite honestly, they are designed for speech first, music second. And it took me weeks of rehabilitation to get the speech back. And then I said to myself, even with the telephone, because the number one thing people with a cochlear implant fear is using the phone. And they're told by doctors 6 months or a year down the road to do it. And what I did after 2 weeks, I decided to call my sister because she knew I was deaf. What the hell are you going to do? You know, that's good. But we wound up speaking for 20 minutes. I only asked her to repeat twice in 20 minutes, but we were crying so hard, it was hard to get the speech out, but it was just fabulous. Now, music itself requires more rehabilitation. And personally, I'm sure Nanette will chime in on this in a minute. I found that jazz music with a lot of brass was the easiest one for me to listen to. I started to recognize some of the instruments first with jazz, not with classical, because the instruments are too, they clash with one another. In jazz, they don't. And then I discovered something very, very cool, because your brain, if you're listening to music you were familiar with, because remember, I hadn't heard anything in 35 years. So I go back to the old Beatles, I go back to stuff from the 60s. And at first it sounds terrible. It sounds awful. But I found a way to, combine speech with the music, meaning I would take the YouTube and do a search for a particular song and add the word with lyrics. So when you're listening to the song with lyrics,
yeah,
it started to come back, and it came back fast. Oh. Your brain needs to know what the hell you're listening to. I did that. Now, the next step I want to do is to help people to learn how to hear individual instruments. And Cochlear had a program called Bring Back the Beat that has different programs like that, where they try to train you to hear particular music and step it up. But what I did is I approached 28 world-class musicians, and I said, would you give me a two-minute clip of your drums or your guitar or whatever instrument you play? And on my website, which is called cochlearimplantbasics.com, cochlearimplantbasics.com, if you go to the top of the landing page, you'll find a link for music rehab, which will take you to the page with these 28 musicians. You can pick the instrument, listen to the loop over and over and over again until it starts to make sense. That's what I did. And today, as you can see behind me, I listen to everything. The trick that I use right now, if you're not a user of Cochlear brand, if you have something else, there's always some kind of TV streamer that you have, which will work with your hearing aid or will work with your cochlear implant. I don't watch that much TV, so I plug that TV streamer into a turntable, and I can listen to vinyl. I can hear the difference. This is very cool. I can hear the difference between the warmth of vinyl and the coldness of a CD.
Yeah.
It takes a little practice, but you can do it. So I like to listen to vinyl. The other trick, this is the mini mic, which is for Cochlear.
Yeah, okay. I have one.
This can be plugged into anything, and it will stream the music directly to your head. The third trick is to Spotify. Spotify, you can get a free version. You can't do that much with it because you can play like 6 songs an hour, but almost all the songs on Spotify have captions. So if you go to something you want to be familiar with, you want to learn it again, Spotify is great. I haven't bought a paid version, but the free version is fine. So those are basically the tricks that I use. And what we can do now, I'm going to turn it over to Nanette, and she's going to introduce herself and tell you a little bit about the method she uses to help you understand music better. Again, if you have any questions, keep popping them up on the chat, because we're going to have plenty of time to talk. So Nanette, take it away.
Okay. Hello. Yeah, I'm Nanette Florian, and I come from a family of hearing loss. When I was growing up, my dad had big hearing aids. It was a big part of our life. And I started wearing hearing aids when I was around 19. I think I was born with not great, but I was also born with a musical talent. So you put the two together and it can be kind of sad, actually. So I wore hearing aids since I was like 19. When I became 40, I had to stop playing. music. I sang and played the piano, and I'll get into that a little bit more. I traveled around the country as a professional musician and everything. I was really grateful for 40 years of being able to hear music, and then it just left me. I mean, I was at, for 10 years, I had big hearing aids, and I was at the point where I would stand in front of a person just trying to understand what they were saying, right? And so after that 10 years was up, I figured out that I would be able to get some help with a cochlear processor. And so I got one, that was 15 years ago. And it was quite amazing to me. I was hoping that I would be able to see like a show of hands, how many people are wearing hearing aids, how many people have cochlear processors, and how many people struggle to hear music. But hearing aids. Oh, someone read out. Yes. Okay, I see it. Okay, and in cochlear processors. Okay. And now, does anyone have trouble hearing? Is anyone struggling to hear music? No. Well, that's really wonderful.
Now they do. They wouldn't be here.
Wait, I just got a cochlear implant from Rita 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. Wow.
Right. How are you doing with it, Rita? Oh, that's right. You just got your surgery. Okay. Right. And the day you're activated is the day you're probably going to hear all this sound that you haven't been hearing for a while. And it comes through like, it's like the Jetsons cartoon, all this crazy sci-fi sound, because that's all the sounds that you haven't heard for a long, long time. I don't know how long for you, but you haven't heard those songs, those sounds. And so they come through like crazy. And the day they activated my processor, I was giggling at all those sounds. I was just laughing. And then I was on my way home. I stopped into the bathroom on my way out of the building, and I flushed the toilet, and it was just nuts. I don't know if everyone else has, experienced that, but I caught on quickly, and I know that not everybody does, but that evening I was, in our bedroom, my husband was in the next room and he was talking on the phone. And remember, I had just come from not being able to hear what anybody's saying at all, ever, even if I'm right in their face, right? It was very difficult. He's on the phone and I could hear every single word he was saying on the phone, and I wasn't even in the same room as him. So I caught on really fast. And but the thing that I struggled with for the next 10 years or so was music. I had to put that on a back burner. And being a musician, it was really tough. I gave up my singing. I used to play the piano and sing in piano bars. I did a few different kind of musical things. So it was so difficult. So what happened to me is, music was very mushy. It sounded like it was someone threw the radio in the ocean or something. So once in a while, I would hear something come through. Like, we go to a campground in the summer, and there used to be a lot of parties and everything, and people would be playing their music, right? And it was just a whole bunch of mush to me, song after song, mush, 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 and everyone, you know, and I'm the musician, you know, and it was just such a bummer. So, but once in a while, a song would just kind of ring out at me. And I thought, I can hear that. And now I thought, why can I hear that? So I started trying to figure that out. And just like Richard said, a single instrument and is much better than adding layer upon layer of instruments, because they just add too many frequencies in the cochlear processor. Now, I don't know, I'm not a math person. I don't remember numbers, but I don't know how many frequencies our processors process at once, but it's about maybe, you know, if you compare it to this amount where music is like this amount of frequencies for the normal, for a person who hears normally. So we can only hear a certain amount of frequencies. So what do we do? Do we go to listen to the symphony with the 20 violins and all that stuff? Well, that might be kind of difficult because those strings are vibrating and causing lots of frequencies, then they're bouncing all off the walls, unless you go to a really good concert hall and they've got it all under control. So there are definitely instruments that we hear better than others. I did go on Richard's website and I listened to all the musicians that he played those clips. And I think you had a banjo, didn't you?
Yes.
I love the banjo because
I'll interrupt you for a second. Of the 28 musicians that donated those clips, the only one I've never been able to find is a harmonica player. For some reason, they are a big pain in the ass. They wanted hundreds of dollars for a 2-minute clip.
Well, they know their thing. They've been playing in the bars for years. I would think a harmonica would come through pretty good because it's a sharp, clear sound. So, you know, even a guitar, a 6-string guitar is a lot of vibrations coming out. But if you played an electric guitar with a single lead like Santana in that wonderful song, Oye Como Va, where Santana comes out with this, his guitar ringing. Oh my God, I just get chills and I can hear that. So what I've come up with is, yes, single instruments and different single instruments, like the piano. I think we all know that there's tons of strings behind the keyboard. And so, sure, if you hear just a few notes, so here, if I'm playing the piano, I might play just one bass line and just a few notes on top. And that is so much better than rattling away, you know, which is what I used to do when I played piano bars, but single sounds. And like I said, the orchestra is like crazy amount of sounds, but if you have one cello or even a quartet, you know, bring it down to the quartet. And like Richard said, jazz, I love jazz because first of all, we can all hear, we can hear the rhythm. We can hear the drums, right? And so that's not a problem. And then you can add the bass, an electric bass or an acoustic bass. The drummer and the bass player always work nicely together for me.
I'll just 1 second here because we were talking about jazz. And if anybody's interested, one of the apps that I love is called radio.net. And I look for jazz stations on that. There's something called Global Swing Broadcast Sweden.
Can you add that to the...
It should be on the captions down there. Okay, it's called Global Swing Broadcast Sweden. They have the clearest jazz of any station I've ever listened to. So there's a tip. I'm sorry to interrupt.
No, that's fine. I also wanted to say that I got a Kanzo 2 recently. I went from my old nuclear freedom thing processor to the Kanzo 2. And I'm not sure I'm hearing better, or maybe I need to regulate what my, you know, the sensitivity and all that stuff. But I love it because it's like this little button on the back of my, I don't have the hearing aids around my ears anymore. And I love all the tech that goes with it. And I love the Bluetooth. And I'm also listening to music in my car. I turn on my own radio station and I listen through Bluetooth. And it's just amazing. And also, you know, we know that the cochlear processor processes your speech, processes speech so nicely, right? But not the music as well. And when you're listening to a song on Bluetooth, I can hear the words for the first time. Like there's a lot of lyrics I never really heard, but on Bluetooth, I'm hearing everything.
I know, this is a very interesting point right here. If you're probably streaming from your phone, when you stream from your phone, if you're bilateral, you get it in stereo. If you stream, if you stream from a mini mic and you're bilateral, it's mono. If you stream from a phone, the phone streamer, TV streamer, it's stereo again. So again, it depends on whether you have one hearing aid, two hearing aids, one cochlear implant, or two. There are different combinations. But if you have two, the options are there for stereo.
Oh, that's nice. I have one. I never wanted to have a second processor because I just wanted one ear to have nothing on it. That's how
that's interesting. You're the first person I've ever spoken to who said that. Why?
I just wanted to be free of it. And so I thought just one side is enough. Plus I was doing so well with it. I didn't feel like, oh, I'm suffering. I need another one, you know. Plus, but we are moving along in time, so maybe I should stop talking.
No, we're not. We have plenty of time. You keep going.
All right, let me see if I got. Yeah, I think I pretty much covered it. And now I'm going to do a screen share and go to a slideshow. And this is where it gets tricky, okay? Okay, I've got to make sure that you will be able to hear my sound.
Yes, we're here.
It's share fine. Sound. Okay, I worked on this quite a bit. Now I'm going to my PowerPoint. Can you see that?
Yes.
Okay. But I have to set it up. Okay, here we go. We're getting there. I know what I'm doing. Don't get nervous. All right. Okay. So a participant has enabled closed captioning. Okay.
You are. It's closed captioning. So, it's coming.
Okay, so here we are. This is me, okay? I'm 65, and so this was 1960, early 60s. And I started playing the piano and singing when I was around six. My mom taught me. And my father was in World War II. He was in Italy and he saw this picture of Beethoven and he sent it home to my mother because, you know, we were a musical family. So Beethoven was always on the wall watching me as I played and sang, always. And I used to, you know, finish a song and I would look up at him and I'd go, oh, the poor guy, you know, can you imagine losing everything like that and never realizing the same thing was going to happen to me. But I did hear that Beethoven, he wrote his best stuff after he lost his hearing. And also I have a song that I wrote and produced and did a music video on, and it's called Beethoven and Me. And that's the first time I ever wrote a song because I was always busy playing and singing and I never thought I could write, but all the music was inside my head and I can still hear it. I'm sure you all hear music in your head. And so we need to kind of enjoy that. But I was able to do quite a few things with music after I lost my hearing. Only I always had to hire some other girl to do the singing. And that was tough. So, okay, so that's the first slide there. This is supposed to be music therapy. So we're gonna hear some music too. So now my brother, Bill, who's about 5 years older than me. He and I became a musical duo. And when I got out of high school, we bought a motorhome. This is late 1970s. And we traveled around the whole country, signing up, finding an agent in whatever town we went to. It was always a good place, like Key West, or we went to Denver. We went a lot of places, and the agent would find us a place to play, and we'd play there in some lounge for a month, and then we'd get back on the road again. And in the between, I picked up a string bass, because I saw another woman in Nashville at a campground who was playing the bass. They were performing for us, and I said, I can do that. So I got the bass. So we, between the pianos and the guitars, Billy and I had quite a show going. And that whole year, Bill had been carrying a newspaper clipping that the new Christy Minstrels were looking for, were auditioning out in California. And I don't know if anybody on this program is old enough to know who the new Christy Minstrels are. I don't know. To tell the truth, I didn't know who they were. My brother did. And so when we got to Los Angeles, we were actually in Beverly Hills, and we drove up to a payphone. My brother just grabbed it through the window, and he called them and said, we're here and we want to audition for you. And the lady said, we're not listening to anybody now, because that was put in a year ago. And my brother, who you can't say no to, he said, man, get your costume on, we're going in. So I dragged my bass up the stairs. I still remember we didn't switch. That was kind of heavy. Bill brought his guitar, and we get into the office, and Barbara, the secretary, says, kids, I told you we're not auditioning. And so we're like, well, you know, and there was a man in the back room. We could hear his voice, and he said, how do they look? And she says, they look fine. They're good. And so he says, okay, bring them back. So my brother and I, he had his guitar and I had my bass, and we sang The Marvelous Toy by Peter, Paul, and Mary. I don't know if anybody knows that one. It wasn't one of their hits, but and so the guy, you know, after the song was halfway,
It was written by Tom Paxton, by the way.
Oh, how wonderful. Yeah. Okay. Good for you. By the way, I have a lot of Peter, Paul, and Mary on my my radio station, and it's all the original original stuff too. It's all original. So this man said, don't call us, we'll call you. My brother called them every week for a year. And so now at this picture here, a year later, we're playing at the Ground Round on the Cape. The motorhome's parked in the harbor right next door. It was really fun. And they called us and asked if we could be in Beverly Hills in 2 days. And so we did it. And we traveled with them for about a year. And we had to quit because they don't stop traveling. They just keep you going and going and going. And by the way, the new Christy Minstrels were started in the 60s by Randy Sparks. We all know that, right? Some of us older people. And by the late 70s, it was a new group, and they kept adding new people all the time. So let me move on. So this is us in the Christies. Can you see the whole picture, or is it all?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay, so here's me with my bass. And this is my brother. And so, yeah, that was quite an experience we shared in the new Christy Minstrels. And I guess, you know, if you were in the new Christy Minstrels, that gave you a kind of a calling card to move on and other things you want to do. My brother's still out there. And so I came back east and I played piano bars. I was in Florida. I played at the Holiday Inn in Venice for a whole winter. Piano bars. So, and I'm still here at that point. And after that, I started playing in church, which is a really good gig. Everyone's very nice to you in the churches, not the bars. So getting back to what kind of instruments we can hear Okay, now I love this.
Your pictures, yeah. Is that the right one?
Can you see the cat. This?
Yeah, Sophie the cat.
Sophie the cat, okay. This is Charles Lim, and he's a cochlear surgery surgeon, okay? And he goes around speaking about music and cochlear processors. I'm going to, I've asked Richard to maybe put the link to this film that you can check out on your own after, but I'm gonna go to Sophie the cat because Sophie and I have a lot in common. We hear the same kind of instruments. We're awake to certain instruments. So what they did was they put a cochlear processor on a cat who was deaf. And he's gonna play three different songs. And they're gonna, and what they're doing is they're showing you which song the cat can hear through its cochlear processor, okay? And see if any of you can relate to this.
But Beethoven composed music long after he lost his hearing. What that suggests is that even in the case of hearing loss, the capacity for music remains. Okay? The brains remain hardwired for music. I've been very lucky to work with Dr. David Ryugo, where I've been working on, there's deaf cats that are white, and we've been trying to figure out what happens when we give them cochlear implants. This is a cat that's been trained to respond to a trumpet for food.
They train Sophie to hear that trumpet for her lunch, but I still say that that's the one she could hear the best, just like me, okay? And you too. All right. So now, okay, now I'm going to, since this is music therapy, Richard said this is music therapy, so I thought I'd better play some music. So here's one of my favorite horn pieces. Now, like I said, since it's music therapy, let's just relax and listen, okay? This is gonna be a little bit of music for you. We're just gonna relax and enjoy, okay? Maybe, but this is the first one. Okay, moving on. All right, now moving to my radio station. So I started getting excited about gathering a lot of songs. Remember I told you there were songs that I could hear that came through clearly to me? So I started collecting them. And then I got the idea to put them into a radio station. So now I have an internet radio station that plays over like 700 songs. They shuffle all the time. So you don't hear the same songs together all the time. It's a big shuffle. It's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it's worldwide. And I only have a very small handful of listeners because I've never advertised it. So I'm the biggest participant. I think Richard listened to Christmas music, right?
Yes. Yes, I was listening to Christmas music all month. It was great. I loved it.
I got so sick of it. If I heard another I'll Be Home for Christmas, I thought, I can't take it anymore. We played it for two days.
But at this point, why don't you, the call letters, tell them how to reach the radio station so we don't forget.
Okay. It's hearmusicagain.org. hearmusicagain.org. Okay. So now, as Richard said, jazz is fantastic because these guys, they know how to, okay, we've got, remember I said we've got the drums, we've got the bass, they're easy to hear. And then they kind of switch off. This group has four guys playing and who did I say this is? This is Benny Goodman. Okay, Benny, when he's playing his clarinet, everybody else goes back into the, you know, no one else is blasting their instrument out. It's one instrument at a time with jazz. And this is one of the first songs I found from my radio station. And it's still one of my favorites because it's just, his clarinet just rings out so, so nicely. And the funny thing about it is that this came out in 1938 and they knew how to record music then. They weren't adding special effects and there's no reverb. Reverb is what kills us, okay? So just listen to this. It's gonna go on for 2 minutes or so. So let's enjoy it, okay? Music therapy. That's it. Okay.
That's great. No, that's great. You know, I have the album from 1937, but mine has.
Oh my God. 1937. Yeah,
mine has the crackles and the pops because, you know, it's a little worn, but I have the album.
Oh,
you know,
my
the funny
goodness.
Thing is,
wow.
you have me thinking now. You have me thinking now. Yeah, we're talking jazz, and I realize there may be a lot of younger participants here who think we're all fogies, and we are, which is okay. I think the message we have here is learning how to hear the music again is a simple step. I mean, it's done in simple steps. You may not be in love with that particular music, but it's helping your brain understand what music sounds like. So that's just great. One of my other favorites is Glenn Miller, because again, his songs just like this, one instrument at a time, right. If there's singing involved, very clear voice.
Right.
So Glenn Miller's another choice as well.
Right. So the music I collected for the radio station, I listened to thousands of songs, and most of them I reject. And it's the ones that were recorded just so that recording engineer did something right for us. He put the voice out front, or whatever the main instrument is. He just did a really good job for us. Like, I know there's really great recordings and they're loaded with reverb and synthesizers, and that's just not for us. It's got to be simple sound, simple music.
But or good voices, or good voices. That's why Sinatra's still so popular.
Yeah.
His voice comes through.
So I'd like to say something interesting about male voices for me on the cochlear processor, though, is that the beefy male voices always drop a half step for me. So like the song will start up, I can hear what key it's in, I know. And then the singer, like Frank, starts singing, and he's not singing in the same key as to me on my processor as the instruments are. But it's still so good that that's okay. You know, I'm deaf. So if I can, hear really, really well, I'm still enjoying the heck out of it. Like, you always know what the rhythm is, you know what kind of song it is. So what I need to say is that I picked out all my songs are crisp. This is my my motto: crisp, clear, and easy to hear. So
I can verify that. I'm giving you an endorsement right now. It's true.
You're on my station. Fabulous.
I love it.
So it's like when I was at the campground and I heard one song that I could hear. Well, the radio station is fun because it's song after song after song. Every single song, it's your world. You know, it's not. It's for us. But everybody else can hear it too, because it's great music.
I think where we're at this point to discuss the fact that people that are struggling with music, to understand we all have cognitive differences in our brain. This is why I always go crazy over social media when people are asking for recommendations of a hearing aid, because you can take 12 people, give them the same hearing aid, and you're going to have 12 different experiences.
I know. I feel bad about that. I know.
But it's true. It's what it is. So while we're discussing music, I think it's important for people to understand, yes, some people are going to struggle more. Some people will get it right away. Our brains are just different. In the same way, my right ear and my left ear hear very differently.
Oh, yeah.
So it's something to understand and keep in mind.
Right.
Do we have any questions here at all? We're doing such a good job. No one has a question.
I've got Roger.
Okay. Well, I'll do one more song because we're going to run out of time. Do Roger Miller. They'll love it.
Let's skip Roger and we'll just go out. I mean, what time is it?
It's 10 off. We have 10 more minutes.
Okay. All right. Let's just hear my station. It really is for people over maybe 55. It's all the songs. It's all the songs we remember. It's even songs that our parents and our grandparents, because I go all the way back to the Wizard of Oz. There's theater, there's everything, classical jazz. It's all wonderful stuff. But I've got some TV songs like Andy Griffith and Gilligan's Island and stuff like that. So we'll just listen to this one. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So this is the banner for my radio station. Internet, you go on the web for this. You go to hearmusicagain.org. So I'm going to stop sharing. And I'm going to go to one more place, okay? Just my website. Here it is. No. Maybe not.
Okay. Yeah. We have a question here. So I see that Bruce Knapp asked about folks say they experience a shift, a pitch shift in some music in the processor. And you know something, Bruce, I understand that. I think what happens, because I have several of those programs in, which is, of course, the set it and forget it one, which you use every day, and the music setting, which lets everything in. So that, yes, if you're listening to music and you're not streaming it, that music setting prevents the shift. So that's one thing to try. You have to, it just lets everything in. For a while, I was using the music setting as my everyday setting because I just experiment with everything. One thing I like about Cochlear, and I'm sure all the companies have this, is the ability to experiment until you find what works for you. Don't be afraid to shift around. With Cochlear, what you can do is you can play with all this stuff on your phone, on the smart app, and then hit one button and it sends you right back to the clinician setting. So constantly experiment. I do this with headsets. My reason I'm using a headset is this room has a lot of, it's a big room, a lot
reverb.
Of echo. So,
yeah.
Right. So it's what it is. So I'm also going to say before we sign off at some point, my email address is Richard Pocker, is one word, P-O-C-K-E-R, Pocker, P-O-C-K-E-R, @gmail.com. So if you have individual questions, you can send them to me, or you can find my website, which is Cochlear Implant Basics, and or the Facebook site. I'm on Facebook all the time. So always, if you have individual questions, don't be afraid to ask. Nanette.
What?
Come on. The floor is yours.
Okay. All right. I know what I have to do. I have to share. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I get it. Okay. Yeah. And I go to here. Here it is. Okay. So this is the radio station. If you don't mind me showing. Right. And there's a lot of really good, it's not just old folks music either. There's a lot of good funky soul and blues and all kinds of good stuff. So, here we go. We're going to go to the listening page. If I can get rid of us somehow.
Billie Holiday.
There we go. Right. Oh, there's plenty. Yeah, there's Billie Holiday. And I know you like Louis Armstrong, Richard. And Ella.
Yes.
I learned that Ella Fitzgerald and he teamed up. So this is at the moment on the radio station, this is it. This is Billy Joel is singing Just the Way You Are. And right here is my brother John, who also has hearing loss. And he is my in-between song DJ. He does a wonderful job. If you find that you're finding that this is a little slow and not enough for you, you scroll down and the other station, I have two stations and one, this is rock. Right now, Joan Jett is singing, I Love Rock and Roll. And like I said, it's all very hearable, crisp and clear for us, with our hearing struggles. So that's my music page there, rock and roll, funky soul and blues. And then on this main station, it's oldies, classical jazz, country, soft rock, theater. And the country is like good old country, like Hank Williams being recorded at the Grand Ole Opry. It's just wonderful music. So I think that I have covered, so it's hearmusicagain.org. I'll go back to
that. .org.
Yeah, hearmusicagain.org. And I'm also, I'm just putting it up for subscriptions now. So it would be a $3.99 monthly subscription is what, unless I think I should go cheaper. I don't know what to do. I haven't done this yet. What do you think? Do you like $3.99 or $2.99?
I have no clue.
Oh, I thought you were a marketing
master. That's your problem. All right. Well, we got another question here. Use scan. I use programs without any sound suppression. All features turned off. No scan as open as possible. Makes a huge difference for me. Well, Kelly, I can say this. Yeah, I've done it too. My sister always says I have the attention span of a slug. So it's possible I just get bored with something and change to something else. So it's what it is. Yes, a lot of I do know people who don't like scan at all. Fine, that's great. There are 500,000 of us wearing cochlear implants and how many millions wearing hearing aids. So yes, everybody's a little bit different. I think what we've tried to do here is to give a little background to what is possible with music. And again, maybe a month from now or so, we'll do another program and you can send your friends, send your relatives, send anybody. Let's get the audience up and hopefully help people enjoy music again, because that's what it's all about. Like I said, I've read where Darwin pointed out that man invented music before he invented speech. And I really do believe that music's far more important to me. So everybody, thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate your being here. And again, you have our email address. If there's anything we can do, let us know. And we hope to see you again. Oh, wait, another question. One more question before we go off. Enjoy it. Okay, very good. Thank you, Kelly. All right, kids. Everybody be well, be safe. And thank you again for joining us.